the new trains. The railway industry tends to focus on trains and new things in particular. But actually, what we're delivering through the franchise is also a lot more local things. So investing in things that matter for the travelling public. Of the £60 million that we're spending on stations, we've already spent about £7.4 million. We've got a lot more programmes to happen this year and next year. We have put in place quite a significant investment in upgrading the customer offer, both in terms of waiting facilities and information provision. And we've also invested now in over 100 ticket vending machines, which work for us, encouraging people to pay either, well, preferably by their app on their phone, but also the new TVMs and stations. And they're smart enabled and will be part of the Smart North project to enable further and more extensive use. All of the City Line stations have now got TVMs, the new modern TVMs in place. And we've also replaced the ticketing system that Aqueductus used on the trains to make it more reliable and slightly smarter than the previous version. And we've also invested in a significant number of what we call gate lines, which are the barriers and stations. And that's for two or three reasons, really. And one, the most important for us at the moment, is capturing the revenue. So making sure that people are using our services are paying, so that we can see the true value of those services. Secondly, it helps in managing crowds and controlling that, and it also gives us a level of safety and security around the stations. They have gone down very, very well with our staff, and we have seen significant increases in revenue at all of the stations that we've introduced. So we've now introduced far more than we were obliged to do, because it's what people expect to see and gives us greater control over the revenue. I'm sure we can pick that up, because we have a number here in the Liverpool City region. I guess the most obvious one here is the Liverpool Lime Street barrier, which I know the Mersey Travel kept pushing the friendly distance to do for a really long time. I think the other issue that we know, as I'm fully aware, you've got a number of new stations that are opening. We're very keen to make sure that we test out our future customer experience at those stations, so that it's not just rolling out what we've always done, but we really test how we can provide an excellent level of customer experience at places like New Bridge and those where they're construction. Accessibility is a big issue for us. We've got 476 stations and a very, very mixed fleet of trains, so it's almost impossible to provide a consistent level of accessibility for all trains onto all stations with a different level of infrastructure. So you know the infrastructure, the station infrastructure here in the Liverpool City region. You can also know what happens out in rural areas and other urban areas. It's quite complicated for us. However, you will see that by the 1st of January 2020, all of our trains will be fully accessible. So we have new trains, obviously, and all of those refurbished trains, and any other trains that are brought in from around the country. We've done a significant amount with other colleagues in the Arriva group. I would say it's not as fast as I would like on the whole integration piece, bringing bus and rail together, demand responsive. But we have done quite a lot of that, particularly in the Northeast, where Arriva are the biggest transport operator, both in their bus and their various rail franchising operations. Again, we're looking to test that out elsewhere. This is a good site for that to be done with the other services. And we've also invested in quite a lot of customer experience, so increasing the number of people employed, both in our customer experience centre in Sheffield, 45 people there. So there's a lot of good stuff going on, and I'm happy to answer any questions about Sharon, with Sharon in a few minutes. I guess the couple of other things we want to touch on. One is the current dispute that we have with the ROT union, which has now been running for 9 months. And we've had 11 days, and next week we have 3 days. So Monday, Wednesday, and Friday is a further dispute. And this is about the role of the conductor, the future role of the conductor. And I know that you're aware of this issue for locally. They are different, so the Mersey Rail system is different to the North system. And we are, as part of our franchise, looking to improve the level of customer service on board and making sure that the operation that we introduce is fully safe. You can only run railway systems in this country with a fully compliant safety case, but what we would like is the driver to be responsible for opening and closing the doors, giving the conductor more opportunities to fare customer service information, selling tickets and checking tickets. We're part of what is clearly a nationally coordinated industrial dispute now. There's disputes going on at a range of places across the country. And we are continuing to engage as proactively as we can directly with our staff. So we are not engaging in tactics deployed by other franchises. We do have no dispute with our staff. There is a dispute between the union and the contract that we have to offer on behalf of the government. And despite rumours to the contrary, we have limited flexibility in changing that contract. So we are not the Scottish Government or the Welsh Government, we're a contractor to the English Government. And it is very difficult at the moment to try to make progress on discussions about the future role of the conductor because we can't give that cast iron guarantee that there will be a safety critical guard on every train because that's not DCA. So we're stuck in a little bit of a long jam, but again, I'm happy as usual to answer questions. What we have done is we've significantly increased the number of trains operating every strike day. That's gone from 40% to 53%. And that will, next week, will increase again slightly. So we are now getting more people volunteering from our management cohort to operate trains. So we will continue to offer a better customer offer to people on strike days. And in essence, between 7 and 7 is broadly the normal service. So the impact on customers is reducing every time there's a dispute. And we have a number of plans in place that each time a further dispute is announced, we'll try to mitigate and reduce the impact on our traffic. I think next week will be the first test because 3 days is quite a significant impact, and I think that's probably the first real work return to work we've had. Secondly, an issue that I know is dear to many of your hearts is Southport to Manchester line. So again, I'm just going to quickly recap on a little bit of the history. In essence, there was a timetable, an ITT was specified as part of the franchise. The Arriva bid in line with that, and we are trying to make the most of the current infrastructure capacity, but also trying to plan on the additional capacity that Network Rail will deliver as part of their Great North Great Rail North project. Until 2019-2020, we are limited on the volume of trains we have, so we only have so many. Our influx of new trains really starts in 2019, so they're the sort of limiting factors. In the May timetable, we have bid to Network Rail, a bit complicated, but we bid and said this is what we would like to operate. I think we reviewed the bid that Arriva originally put in place, quite a lot of feedback from local stakeholders. We did a survey of customer use, particularly on the use of Victoria compared to the south side of Manchester. And we have bid for the May timetable to operate peak time services that would go into the south side of Manchester and then onto Old Vierge, both in the morning peak and the evening peak, and we all think that's a good step forward if Network Rail can deliver the timetable paths that we require. And we are continuing to work with local groups, and know yourselves here and the Rail North Partnership, to identify whether we can do more beyond that. This is reliant on Network Rail delivering the infrastructure that allows this to happen. I wouldn't underestimate making sure that happens as part of this. We're also looking to do a bit more. So there are potential opportunities to run further services in that corridor, subject to the infrastructure being there, and serving broader markets. So I think this is not just necessarily about Southport and where they go, but where can you bring people from into Southport as a visitor location? And I know when I was here, the visitor into Southport was equally as important. That would require us to have more of these flex vehicles and also more vehicles for us to operate this timetable. But we are actively working with Rail North and local groups to see whether there's a business case for us to do more than we would like to do in May this year. And that could potentially happen from May 19 or December 19. Finally, from May this year, this is the next big step change in service offering, so train service operator offering for people. Again, this is built on quite a lot of research and evidence that people like Shane and others provided into the planning process. So the evidence that said here are markets that are worth serving, these are the ones that we would like to operate as part of the May 2018 timetable, increase in the connectivity of here, both in inter-urban but also in local. And we're clearly, Sharon is the sponsor for our Northern Connect project, which is about an enhanced level of quality of service connecting towns and cities across the north. And again, we're looking to expand beyond what was in the contract, not just over there. So again, hopefully, a significant potential opportunity for us to increase the connectivity from May this year. Again, this is, we can probably discuss this, this is still linked to the ability for the infrastructure to be delivered, because you will have heard me say many times, it's not rocket science. You can only run electric trains where there's electric wires, and that's not always as simple as it may seem, but that's the gist of it. So hopefully that's given you a flavour of what we're going to deliver. It is based on a growing franchise. I think the start really, one of the things that Craig and Sharon are really keen on is making sure that we play our part as part of the major events that you have here. I know how much effort goes into it, and I remember before the heavy rails are part of the bargain, sometimes let us down on some of the big events, but I think building on the work that Liz and others have done over the years is making sure that we're supporting you in those big events. So I hope that's given you a bit of a flavour. There's an awful lot going on. I think it's fair to say it's been not a slow start, but there was a big fanfare in April 2016. A lot of planning and work has gone into getting to the point where we're ready to deliver these new trains, these refurbished trains, the station investment, the new services. Slightly disappointing for me that quite a lot of management time and effort is going into the dispute, but we're getting through, hopefully getting through that so we can get on and deliver the train services and the products that you all negotiated as part of the partnership.
Looking at that, David, I know there'll be lots of questions and comments. We've already got Ron and Ken, and if other people are in the cape recording. Ron.
Thank you, David. As we found interesting today regarding the question for Ashley regarding the smooth integration, let's see a bit more information on what you're doing in the North East. There's obviously been a bit of challenges trying to integrate rail and bus on the city region, but now that the fact is that there's a PLC. Now control 60% of the network, the bus or rail, including the Vista Metro line. Obviously we'd be looking to have a model similar to the one in Cornwall, which delivers a last bus, delivers last bus guarantee and timetable is linked to the train. So people can get train to bus or bus to train. That's something we would like to work with you going forward as a real line project, and maybe deliver something better than speed delivered in the North East. And that's not the detrimental of what's being delivered in the North East, but I know we always get a bit more, and we always get a bit more quality as when we did when we negotiate things. So I look forward to working with your Jan and your people in the very near future. And when I say the near future, in months, not years, to start that progress of looking at how can we integrate our timetable within the city region.
We'd be very happy to do that. Part of the whole arena culture is about trying to be the web's provider of choice. It's called the work we've done in the North East that Mike has led is actually bringing together cross country, Grand Central, Northern, together with the local bus operators. It's not as fast as it should be, but I think we've made great strides there. I think it's a really good opportunity for us to do that because you also have in place quite a lot of the infrastructure, which is the organisational relationships, the multi-local ticketing, etc. So we'll be happy to do that, and then Sharon will be able to discuss it.
Thanks, Sharon. Welcome back, Dave. We can also say our regards back to Craig because he's on some good service for us. Pleased to see you still with him. Where's this topic? We've just read your third successful year of Boxing Day services. Your franchise also includes opportunities to run Boxing Day trains. Will Christmas 2018 see Boxing Day services so that residents in Hyden and St Helens, for example, can enjoy the same service of those that we deliver in Formby and Newbright?
We've got a franchise commitment to run some services on Boxing Days. That's what we're part of the negotiation we have to all, do we want to do those in the most successful places to create a workshop?
If I can just add to that as well, Ken, as part of the May 18 timetable consultation, we have actually asked the local authorities to give us their priorities, which will help us set where we can actually dictate those 60 services that we've got to deliver to franchise.
We've got Jerry, then John, then Gordon, then Mary, then Alan.
Right, so you'll be aware of the pioneering rolling stock that we have enjoyed from the Mersey Rail Network, and the sliding steps incorporated to give all passengers level and lets us. Whilst we appreciate that the network and infrastructure constraints of more network make this more difficult for you to introduce, what are you putting in place to ensure that all disabled people can turn up and travel straight away in the same way they will be able to on Mersey Rail?
If I can pick this one up, I think you're absolutely right. We face very different challenges in Northern than the SEL do because of our infrastructure. And many of the stations that we operate through right way across the North are actually Victorian stations and therefore not accessible. What we are doing as part of our station improvement fund is trying to identify those locations which would benefit from things like easy access areas. We're working with Network Rail to make sure that any station improvements improve accessibility. And it's a campaign, so what we aim to do within the legacy of this franchise is actually leave all of the stations in a far more accessible position than they were at the beginning. But given the size of our estate, that's a very big challenge, so it has to be done on a needs base.
John.
Thanks, Chair. Welcome back, David. Happy New Year. As you know, Mersey Travel is the largest active smart ticketing area anywhere outside of London. Your franchise applies to other ticketing schemes in the city region areas. Could you tell us how you would want to link to our plans and use Walrus, whatever it becomes, on your new rail services in the local city region? And then finally, with the funding and platform validators of Mersey Rail via Smart in the North, it would make the local city region a natural place to start with your own smart ticketing plans. Thank you for that.
We're absolutely committed to Smart in the North project. We have an active presence in Mersey Travel Smart project. We've just recently signed our side agreement to commence tranche one of Smart in the North. We are looking to reap the benefits of that for our customers. So I think it's fair to say we're very much at the table and we'll continue to support and deliver in every way we can. And part of the infrastructure that we're already putting in will allow us to have ITSO validation on our TVMs, our gate lines, and also on board with our conductor
equipment. Thank you very much. Before I welcome you back to the table, I'll wait to see what your answer is to me. I'm not quite as easy going as it. Obviously, I think you've got an idea and might be asking you lots of questions. I think you covered off where we got to, where we come to in effect with the start of the franchise submission, which was unclear to us, you know that. I think the little bit of a reminder for you is just to say, I hope you do recall that the retention of services, the further facilities, is something that was supported across all the parties, the councillors, Don, Carr, McKinley, the same sector. Written by the chief executive and leading the council. It was then supported by the leaders of the council across all the parties at the combined authority. And also, I'm led to believe that it was very empathetically received by the minister, Mr. Paul Maynard, so, and maybe because he shares a constituency with similar outlook. You mentioned Opstat and the SLTF. I'd also include some of the requests to your predecessors from Rosie Cooper and Lisa Nandy. There's all these people I don't have this to say it's so important for self-realise. So what I'd like to really know and to give me some assurance, because every time I've heard something it's evaporated and changed, not your fault all the time. Can you assure us, mate, that there'll be a retention of the current service until your planned May timetable rolls into fruition, so we'll keep the aircraft? what the MP will say as it is. Nothing's changed for me then.
Yes.
Sorry.
But yes.
Thank you. And one of the other things that happened, and this is the first time I've done this before, is last year we did have a amazing travel meeting, and what we did agree with, we looked away from Tulsa at amazing travel and yourselves to draw up that business case. I think that's something we'd like to see. Put firmly back on the table and move ahead, because I think we've all got the interest, we've seen your investment, we all want to see everyone doing well. Just feel it's been a little bit, it's like smoking miniatures. You can look through it, you're just not sure where you are. And, oh, we all, I would never dream of blaming this government less, but I don't think they've got any shape or form. But that would be a great deal of help to us.
Yeah, I'll start. We're working very closely with Rail North and the to make sure that we've got this case that is very well seen, and then identify whether
I think since our last meeting in Gordon, where we've got to is the existing timetable arrangements remain in place until May 18. But May 18 is still a little bit of a moving feast, so all of the bids have gone in for May 18. It's the biggest timetable change in generations that Network Rail are having to deal with. As a result, that's throwing up a number of clashes that we're having to work through. So until we resolve the May 18 issue, which we're expected to do in the next couple of weeks, we don't have the base in which to start a business plan for the next stage, but that doesn't mean we're sitting complacent. So one of the things that we've done is actually created a framework for the development of the business plan, so that hopefully from the end of this month we'll be able to get all parties back around the table and start that active discussion. And what I will assure, as I did last time, we are committed to this, we know how important it is, and we will work as hard as possible to make those numbers fit and to create that interest within government to get the rolling stock to deliver what we need.
Thank you, Chair. I don't think I'll be adequate to come from Sharon's mention of it.
And I'll just add on that point as well, which will be helpful. Not just about kind of the existing service pattern and how that might develop. I think what would be really, really useful for Northern is if you could work with us on two specific medium to longer term objectives for Southport. One would be getting Southport onto the Northern Connect network, giving it a kind of intercity style service, but also as well how we get the journey time from Southport to Manchester under 60 minutes, because I think that would make it a much more attractive line for people going in both directions. Mary.
Welcome back, David. You know that affordability for young people has always been one of our key priorities, David, and we've had not insignificant success with the bus companies on that one. Scored a few points and got a few kids happy, and a few more bob and a few parents' pockets. You notice now that the rail companies are trying to do stuff as well, particularly Merseyrail and Transpennine with the 16 to 19-year-olds. The question is, what do you think to
that? Yeah, that's a really good question. We've got no current plans at the moment, but I'm more than happy to someone.
Yeah, absolutely.
And but I'm more than happy to get part of Sharon's team to work with you here to see whether that could work on the Northern services in that area as well, because I know how successful it's been, so it would be sensible for us to do that. Can't promise anything. We don't have any plans on a completely wide basis at the moment. We're more than happy to commit to doing that.
And what I would say, Mary, is actually we could look at potentially trialing. So we've done in other parts of the West region, we've trialed for certain education authorities, sort of 16 to 19 season ticket built on the academic year. So that's perhaps something we could look at. And also, government as a whole are looking at potentially the extension of the young person's rail card.
Thank you. Thank you for that, David. I cannot welcome and continue back. I wasn't here when you were here. But yes, there's a couple of things here. First of all, people tend to have a good mold about various things. Many people have a good moan to to me personally about everything. One thing they are having them on about since they've known I haven't been here, toilets on trains from St. Helens into Liverpool. They are often out of order. That is one question. If you want to answer that, then
yeah. Yes, that's partly due to, I'm not an expert in this, but it's partly due to the capacity of the tanks on the trains. So that actually we don't have the ability to empty them out, yeah. Therefore, when we plug them out, we have a plan for that, and we're doing some investment to enable that to happen. So not necessarily in the short term, but we've got something in the motion, literally in motion.
Yes, thank you for that. The second point, I represent Confidence Council. We have a little old station there, wasn't one time a big junction, but not anymore. People turn up there, it is unmanned, they've no idea if trains are late or whatever. People are asking me, can we have digital notice boards on when the trains are coming, if they're late or whatever. Now, in the next 10 years or so, I know the station is due for a big revamp, but what about the time between now and then?
What I'll do is I'll actually check whether or not it's already scheduled as part of the initial works we're doing over the next 2 years to get CIS customer information screens in, and I'll come back to you.
Oh, yes, please. Yeah, thank you.
Jeff, Patrick.
Yeah, thank you. Really just asking your views on the merits and the opportunities of the high-speed railways between Preston and Eastgate to Manchester, and of course from there on then directly down to London. And of course with that directly down to London, does that become then high-speed railway?
My personal opinion is it's a very good idea, I would say that from my computer shop. The one thing that I found in this new job is that there's only so much you can get out of existing infrastructure. Our railways are quite old, and when you try to improve them, it often produces a lot more problems than you think it's going to improve. And it's very clear to me that we can't continue to try and put different sorts of train services on the same track. So when you try to do that, so you freight trains, stopping trains, semi-fast trains, fast trains, you just can't do that. Therefore, if you're going to dramatically improve the journey times between the big cities in particular, so if you were to go back to, say, Liverpool, to Manchester, across to Leeds, and then further, if you're really going to significantly reduce the journey time and run lots more trains, you need to do that on a new line. And that's just the obvious logic that the government came to about High Speed 2, and is coming to elsewhere, where you do need at some point to build new capacity. So I think it's an excellent idea, and that would allow us then to run more trains on the existing network to complement the local services and to complement the high speed services.
Patrick. Thank you, Chair. That's very encouraging, the work that you're doing in Blackburn. My question relates to Northern's approach to how you're working with the Gulf City region, which has a devolved budget for learning and skills. The idea of bringing the needs of industry closer to what training actually takes place, with the intention eventually of opening up job opportunities for people in deprived communities. I am also aware that there has been some work being undertaken looking at a skills strategy for transport. So my three questions, one relates to have Northern been involved in the skills strategy. How closely are you aligned in a strategic view to the Liverpool City region's intention of bringing the training closer together? And what are you doing for apprenticeships?
So to start at the bottom on those, we've got bringing up all about 21 apprentices every year throughout the franchise. And that's already proving invaluable to us across the business. So a significant number in engineering and then we also recruit graduates and year in industry people. So it's not just full time people, we've got a range of opportunities to that. We're involved in the skills strategy at a strategic level, so making sure we're feeding in the gaps that we've got, because we've got an aging profile of employees, so we will have gaps in numbers of people, but also in skills, which are around engineering that we'll want
So again, you know, happy to pick that up, but that was the purpose of creating Bridger Director, so that they can plug into those skills arrangements. And Blackburn's just a really good example of where it's not just about running trains, but the economic impact of everything we're doing there is quite significant. We're trying to do that a little bit more. It's trying to get the sort of rail industry to look outside the rail industry.
Thanks, yeah. Thanks, David. Welcome back. David, Robert Carlton Depot is one of the successors from previous franchises. What's the future plans for Carlton Depot? What important job is going to be there?
So the short answer is there's no increase in jobs at Allerton as part of the new rolling stock, but there is an investment in skills. As David said, you know, currently we've got people who are maintaining very old rolling stock and we're about to give them a brand new kit. That's a transformation for a lot of our teams. So there's a big investment in skills, but also the infrastructure in Allerton. So making sure that it's ready to receive these brand new trains. And whilst we're not creating jobs at Allerton, what I would say is, as part of the timetable uplifts that we're seeing in December and May and into next year, we have seen a significant uplift in employment in Liverpool Depot, Wigan, and across our retail portfolio. So whilst we may not be creating jobs in Allerton, we're definitely creating jobs in the Liverpool City region, as David evidenced by the sort of 5,805 people that we have in our business today.
I mean, genuinely, I mean, again, this is not rocket science because we're trying to run more services and maintain new trains. We need more people because we've got an aging employee base and we need to employ more. So literally, we were doing 384 people last year, and that's just a steady stream. So conductors, we've got 150 conductors that have joined us and are now operating trains that weren't with us in April last year. So they're not small numbers, they're genuinely big numbers. And here, you know, that increase is happening in places like Wigan and Liverpool.
John?
Yeah, thanks.
Yeah,
thanks, Chair. As you're aware, David, the Liverpool City region has invested in like 18 million in construction of brand new multi-road state strategic park and ride provisions at Newton Willows. What quality of service provision and customer experience do you intend to implement to maximise usage of this key upgraded gateway hub? And secondly, could you outline any commercial or community plan considerations for the use of the redundant listed station?
If I can take that one, that would be great. For us, Newton and Willows is a real game changer. We want to see a real change in our retail strategy. So one of my big challenges is we actually, our average ticket price across Northern is £3.80, and we sell that behind bulletproof glass, which in this day and age is a really crazy philosophy. We want to get our people out and about engaging more with our customers. And we're actually just about to kick off a piece of work about how we take best practice right the way across the industry and implement that into the retail offering at Newton Willows. So we expect to see something very different from that which you see in the other northern stations along the line of route. In terms of the redundant building, we see that's a great opportunity both from a commercial perspective but from a community perspective. So one of the things that we have an objective to do and deliver within this franchise is actually invest money in bringing redundant buildings back into use for both commercial and community. And our commercial and community manager is now looking at Newton Willows with a view of potentially a retail unit on the bottom and a community unit that sits above it. So we think it's a really exciting opportunity.
And further questions, I'll sort of ask a couple. First of all, it's great to see the sort of acknowledgement about transport, especially about yourself to our city region. I think it's fair to say over the past few years, the collective approach has really improved, but I think still more that we can do. One of the things that's been quite useful on certain bespoke occasions, whether it's been sort of in the run to Christmas or other special events, is on Merseyrail and the bus network, run quite late night services. You said that's not much straightforward with the infrastructure, but is there an opportunity where it might be appropriate that we could potentially run some service up to about 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning if that was required?
I mean, for us, yes, in principle, but as you know, the whole signal box opening and all that sort of conversation is a bit complicated. We're already engaged with Network Rail about opening signal boxes early and later than they currently do, and on weekends and stuff like that. So if there's any specifics that we want to feed into that, then we can pick up at the same time. We can't promise anything because it's far more complex than it is here on the Jersey Rail, but the thrust of it is, if you could, we can.
And then the other one that's probably remiss of me not to mention, you did touch on the industrial action, and I think we all know that that's not straightforward to resolve, but I think certainly our strong view is that with any dispute, the only way that you can ever successfully solve it is with dialogue and negotiation. What are you doing as a company to try to promote that dialogue and negotiation? Because, for example, here in the city region, our own Metro Mayor and all our leaders and ourselves have called for no precondition conciliation mechanism just to try to get talking started. What are you trying to do to be able to form the court to try to get them talking?
Okay, so, within the existing machinery, so we're having a regular dialogue with both the drivers and the conductors union at a national level. We had a meeting yesterday with our RMT representatives at a local level, and we're engaging very closely with our staff as much as we possibly can without circumventing the official regime. But I have to say, it's quite difficult because we want to talk about the role of the conductor moving forward, and the RMT's position is they will only have that discussion as long as we guarantee that there will be a guard with the same responsibility today. Bit of a complicated circular conversation where we can't have the conversation that we would like to have. We did do some work about 16 months ago on explaining to staff what the future might look like for their roles. I think we're now thinking that we ought to do that again so that we can at least explain how this might play out and where it might work, because this is not for taking people off the trains across the system. This is about getting people dealing customer service and making sure the trains are safe, getting conductors and the station staff to look after customers, and the driver opening those doors. It's not uniform because Cumbria is different to the full city region, and we just need to now find a way where we can try to explain that a bit more directly to our staff so that they're hearing it from us. And it's very difficult because my personal opinion is, as we put on the slide, we've been now swept up as part of something which is much bigger than Northern, fortunately, because we were the first franchise with this in as a commitment, we're in a slightly different place to those that have been let since. So again, there's a lot of work going on within the industry and the department to try and work on these models. But this is, you know, again, you wouldn't expect me to say this, but we're trying to modernise the way we run rail services. We have offered our conductors a role and their existing salary through to the end of our franchise, which is 2025. And the Secretary of State has now offered that beyond that period of time. So potentially people have the offer of a role and an existing salary with an annual pay increase for up to 17 years. And that is just unprecedented. That just doesn't happen outside. So again, we're saying the role will be different, but you know, there's anybody else that you can choose at this stage in that role. And actually, we need more people doing the roles because we're running more services.
Brilliant. Well, if there's no further questions or comments, thanks ever so much for taking the show. Obviously, it'd be great to see me back here in the future. Yeah, but thanks for watching the show. I appreciate you. Thank you very much. Okay, from trains onto buses then. Next up, as item 5, is the quarterly bus report. And Laura's going to present that one for us.
Thank you, Chair. Good afternoon. The report in front of you provides an update on key activities that have provided Liverpool City Region bus lines and major travels bus departments throughout the third quarter of 2017-18. It updates on progress to develop bus lines and business investment plan for the next financial year, as well as on the delivery milestones in the current business investment plan. Some of these include the continued rollout of Wi-Fi access across the Arriva and Stagecoach fleet, with a commitment in the 2018-19 plan to reach 100% Wi-Fi access by the end of April 2018, the delivery of a successful driver customer service training programme delivered to Arriva and Stagecoach drivers, altogether a total of 836 drivers have attended one of the 90 courses that have been running to date. And the second module is planned to be written and funding sought to deliver in 18-19. The average age of vehicles operated by the Alliance continues to reduce, well below the target of 7 years. Currently, Stagecoach fleet is 3.7 years and Arriva's fleet averages 6.1 years. The NOSI network review initial consultation period commences on the 17th of November and will be implemented across Knowsley by the 22nd of July 2018. The report also provides an overview of the Better Bus campaign, which continues to raise awareness of how easy bus travel throughout the region is, and an action plan for the 18-19 campaign has been delivered, which prioritises workplace engagement as well as continuing to deliver a successful schools engagement programme. The report also highlights the awards that the Bus Alliance has received this year. Whilst the Bus Alliance enhances the network through improving commercial services delivered by the region's two biggest operators, Mercy Travel's bus and legal teams have been working closely together on a project to radically improve the conditions of contract and therefore improve the bus offer of our supported services. New conditions of contracts have been developed and the deadline of the 22nd of April has been set for operators to confirm their migration to these new conditions. The next stage of the programme is to develop, test and launch a dynamic purchasing system which will provide the opportunity to assess quality as well as cost as part of the tender. It is also worth noting that Mercy Travel officers are working with the Confederation of Passenger Transport to engage smaller bus operators from across the city region in discussions to encourage growth in the membership of the Bus Alliance. The bus team has also been taking the lead on exploring the new powers that Bus Services Act 2007 gives to mayoral combined authorities in which they can use to further improve bus services. Members will be aware that the first stage of the process, the development of the Strategic Outline Programme, or STOP, was completed in June 2017. The second stage has been the development of the Strategic Outline Case, or SOC, which builds on the issues identified in the initial SOC. This is currently being consulted on and will be brought to members as a briefing in March 2018. The finalised Strategic Outline Case is scheduled to be considered by the Transport Committee in March, and the combined authority in April. At this stage, work will begin on delivering an OBC or an outline business case. Finally, the report does touch on and provide an overview of the recent industrial action by members of the United and GMB unions at Arriva, which has led to disruption to bus services on a number of days during quarter three. This dispute has now been resolved as a result of positive dialogue between the unions and Arriva management. If there are any further questions,
questions or comments from anyone? It's reasonably so straightforward, so very good, very good. So our thanks to yourself and the whole team, and look forward to further report, particularly the strategic outline case that will be coming forward in the next couple of months. Look forward to that accordingly. If there aren't any further questions or comments, if I can move recommendation in paragraph 2 of the report, if that's agreed. And then on to item 6, which is the Liverpool City Region Right of Way Improvement Plan, and John's going to give us a presentation.